Always nice when I have some guests in the studio, and today I've got the team from Rollasons Solicitors with me. We've got Gemma and Natalya. Hello, ladies. How are you doing?
Hi.
So today we are talking all about the world of law, but also the world of law, particularly where it affects people who are from Eastern Europe, and maybe it's all a little bit more, I mean, to be fair, it's quite scary and complicated for everybody, but possibly more difficult when English isn't your first language, or when you've moved here and there's a lot of stuff to deal with. There's a lot of things to tackle. And Rollasons Solicitors are specialists in this because they have Natalya working for them, and you're Polish. So
yes,
hello. How lucky. So do you find that there's a lot of people who come to you that need some assistance on the legal side, and you're there to help them? What are the kind of things that people need help with?
It's mainly, I'd say, with the forms. They can be quite long, and the questions not very clear for a lot of Eastern European people to understand. So I tend to go through the forms with them, explain what we need to fill in, put in the forms, that kind of the things, and finding a lot of documents, especially when it comes to sale of the house. You have to have like a pack, bundle of documents ready to give to your solicitor when you're selling your house. And a lot of them can be very difficult to find, and just to assist them, where to look for them, what do they look like, perhaps we could look online, and just things like that, really.
Because I think that is, you know, for everybody that's buying and selling houses, the paperwork can be daunting, because it's all, there's lots of questions that you just, when you come to it, you think, I don't really know what you're getting at here. There's a legal question here, and I'm not sure whether I've got a P312 form or if I need to do a W36 or whatever. And that's, I think, obviously why you need a solicitor to help when you're buying and selling a house. But as you say, even more difficult when you've got a big form to fill in, and a lot of people are expected to fill in a lot of the form themselves.
And we do tend to ask for quite a lot of paperwork as well. Yes, that's in terms of a sale of a house. But when it comes to purchasing the property, the purchase process is completely different as well. And when it comes to reporting to your client on the paperwork that we have received from the seller's solicitor, then you tend to get like hundreds of pages of different paperwork, whether it's searches, title documents, anything, or replies to inquiries, and they look at this, it's just like, oh my God, what am I supposed to do with this?
Yeah.
And we tend to then just sit down with them, ask them to come in for like half an hour, 45 minutes, and then I'll go through the documents with them and explain in just a plain language what it's all about.
So I think one of the worries that people have with legal stuff anyway, with solicitors, and it is an issue sometimes, is that the time that is spent on it, sometimes the clock's running, and just to sit down with the solicitor and have a meeting is costing money. Does it work like that, or do you have like a standard fee for doing the conveyance?
No, we tend to quote a fixed fee, but we do time record every single time we spend on the matter. So if it does exceed like quite a lot, it's a lot more than what we quoted, then we do tend to go to the client and say, look, we've spent a lot more time than we allocated to deal with your matter. But there are different factors. It could be something that's it's just been dragging on. So if it's a purchase and there's a chain and something happened, you know, halfway through, and then it's out of our control, this is where we go back to the client. So look, we're going to have to up our fees a little bit. But then again, it's out of our control.
But I think that's reasonable if you're spending months and months.
But we do tend to tell the clients like halfway through the matter. So, okay, we've spent too much time dealing with a particular matter, and then we need to review our fees. But then we do let the clients know at the onset of the matter when that we will be time recording. And that if we do exceed the amount quoted, that we'll have to review the fees. So it's not something that we just, you know, throw at them halfway through. Okay, look, we're going to charge you extra.
Sure.
So we do tell them from the very beginning what the conveyancing process is as well.
So are there a lot of people from Eastern Europe that try and get on the property market in this country?
Yes, there's quite a lot of first-time buyers, buy-to-let clients, people who just wanted to buy a bigger house because of, you know, the families extending. So, yes, or just moving elsewhere because they found a job, you know, in a completely different area. So, yes, there's quite a lot, actually, and which is lovely to see.
Yeah, absolutely. And do some people come to you and they say, right, I've got a house in Poland that I want to sell and I want to buy a property in the UK. Is that something you can help with, or would you need a solicitor in Poland?
You would need a solicitor in Poland. We cannot do that for them or anywhere abroad, actually. We can only deal with properties that are based in UK.
Okay, but you can obviously
So if they do want to use the sale proceeds from a property they sold abroad, then we'll need to see the proof that they have sold the property from their solicitor or conveyance, and then we'll use that as a like a purchase money for a property they want to buy in UK.
It's just coming up on 11:15, and it's great to have the team from Rollasons Solicitors with us in the studio, answering your questions and talking about the world of legal stuff where it applies specifically to people from Eastern Europe, because we've got Natalya with us, who's Polish, and also Gemma. So thank you so much for spending your morning with us in the studio here today. Gemma, I wanted to ask you what the housing market is like at the moment, because we hear a lot of stuff on the news about doom and gloom and the fact that interest rates are skyrocketing and it's very difficult to get a mortgage, and property prices apparently are going down at the moment. So are people still quite keen to get on the property ladder?
I think there's still quite a lot of people that are willing to buy and to move, and rent is sky high, which is always a good motivating point for people to try and buy so they can start putting money into their own property and start investing for themselves. It has slowed a little bit, but it is quite normal for this time of year. It is school holidays. People tend to sell less during those times anyway. And normally we see a bit more of a boom in sort of September and January times after those school periods are finished. And then after the Christmas period as well, people tend to be quite motivated to move. So, I mean, if there's anyone out there that is looking to buy, I wouldn't be put off by it. It's taken quite a natural course. Interest rates do go up and down, and there's never really a bad time to buy a property, or to at least start thinking about it.
Yeah, because inflation's coming down, so hopefully, I mean, I think interest rates might go a little bit higher, but then they'll start coming down again maybe in sort of 6 to 12 months, hopefully. That's what everybody's hoping. So you know, when you buy a property, it's very much a long-term plan anyway, so you've got to look sort of 20 years into the future sometimes, and things will be very different then than they are now. So yeah, you've got to kind of take a long-term look. But I guess also when you're buying property and you have to deal with this side of things, if you've got a chain and everybody else is trying to buy and sell houses and things have slowed down, then everything seems to just take a lot longer.
Yeah, everyone's in the same boat at the end of the day. So even though you're thinking, wow, interest rates are really high, they're high for everyone. So the house prices are going to reflect that. The market is going to reflect that. So, you know, you're not on your own with it. And I think sometimes people think, oh, but I'm going to be paying all this money, but everyone's doing the same things and people are still able to move, and there is a lot of help out there. And I would recommend, if you're thinking about it, the first thing really, speak to a mortgage broker, just see what products are out there. There are some good 2-year and 5-year fixed deals, and they'll be able to guide you how much your repayment's going to be, how much do you need to earn, what deposit are you looking at, and that will be for you a really good idea and a lot of information of, okay, well, now I need X amount, let's aim towards this. Okay, I can go for these property prices, so let's look in these areas. I think that's probably the best place to start.
Yeah, very good advice. And the other area that you deal with is helping people with a kind of business law and kind of contracts and things relating to businesses, and especially with people from Eastern Europe. Do people from Eastern Europe have a different way of doing business sometimes that they need help kind of reminding that contracts are important, maybe?
Well, commercial conveyancing is a little bit different than residential conveyancing. So the process is completely different. And we do tend to find quite a lot of people, not just the Eastern European people, but a lot of people do tend to do just like a closed deal between the landlord and a tenant, don't involve a solicitor, shake of hand, okay, here you go, here's the property, here's the key to the unit. But we do really would like to tell people that it is very important to come and see a solicitor, involve a solicitor in this transaction, to make sure whether you are a landlord or a tenant, that you do, if you are a landlord, that the tenant will be able to pay the rent on regular basis, will not fall into arrears. It's like with the tenant, if you want to rent the unit, the building, or any kind of a commercial premises, to make sure that the landlord is the actual landlord. Mm. And again, there's like no debts behind for you to pay once you sign the deal. So it is quite important to actually do come and see a solicitor and make sure you're getting what you're supposed to be getting.
Yes, lots to deal with. Okay, well, we're going to have some more music now. I've got a Polish song for you. I hope you like this one. This is Beatyka Żydrak and Gambit.
Thank you.
Great song from Beatyka Żydrak. Did you enjoy that?
Yes, lovely.
Good
Thank
stuff.
You.
I didn't realise she's quite old, isn't she, for a pop
yes,
star?
Yes, I think she's in her like quite 60s or very late 50s.
Wow, you wouldn't think it listening to that,
no,
though.
No, she's doing quite well, actually, yes.
Yeah, it's a banger.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to chat a little bit more about buying property, and we've got the team with us from Rollasons Solicitors who deal specifically in... Well, you deal with everything, but you particularly help people from Eastern Europe if there's a language barrier, or if they just want a friendly face to kind of help them through the legal minefield that you sometimes have to contend with. And it must be difficult for people just making that decision about which solicitor to use sometimes. So being completely, you know, impartial and neutral, how would somebody go about choosing a good solicitor? What are the kind of questions that you should be asking? What are the things to watch out for?
So when you're buying a property, you'll likely get recommendations from a solicitor, from your estate agent, from your mortgage broker, from your neighbour, from your parents. There'll be a lot of information coming at you. And I think that sometimes people fall into a bit of a trap whereby their estate agent or their mortgage broker has recommended someone, and they can sometimes feel a little bit pressured to use them. When you're looking for a solicitor, the best thing you can do is just do your research. Have a look at their reviews online. What are other people saying about them? If there's a language barrier, is there someone there that speaks the same language? Because you think, oh, okay, it'll be fine, but it's really difficult. A lot of English people struggle with it, let alone if it's not your first language. So I would really say do your research. Don't feel pressured to go with someone just because your agent or your neighbours told you, no, you have to use them. That's not the case at all. And you know, if they've got really good reviews and you've called them up and they're really responsive and they sound really happy to be taking your call, and you know, it's not just an online service where you can't actually speak to anyone, then that'll be the best option for you. And you know, just because they're the most expensive or just because they're the cheapest, it doesn't mean that they're the best.
Yeah, because I think a lot of the time, you know, it is a lot less expensive to go with a website where you get everything done on a web portal and you don't actually ever talk to anyone. But when you come across problems or you don't understand something, that's when you need somebody to talk to that can actually guide you through it. And it's quite daunting to try and do everything yourself.
Yeah, I mean, not all cheap solicitors are going to be bad solicitors at all, but you've got to think about, okay, I have gone quite cheap on this, and they're a firm that are 200 miles from me, and I've never been able to speak to them. And you have to accept the fact that maybe the transaction does drag on for longer than you wanted. That isn't always going to be the case just because they're cheap, but that's why research is so important. And you know, just making sure that they've got to be the right person for you. You're paying them a lot of money, and it's a big investment. You're spending a lot of money. You've got to make sure that when you're buying a house or you're selling a house, it's done correctly.
But I think also sometimes if a firm is too big and they are one of these really big expensive firms, sometimes you don't get that same level of service that you get with a smaller more friendly kind of local firm?
I don't think you tend to get to speak to the same person twice. Yeah. So it's like with us, you know, you always come to the same person or their assistant if the solicitor or conveyance is not available. And then you can just telephone, pick up your phone, and you know that someone will call you back very, very shortly, or you will get to speak to them and you will get to ask the question and get an update on the case.
Brilliant. Well, we've pretty much run out of time because it's nearly 11 o'clock, but thank you so much for taking the time out to join us today. And I hope that's answered some questions for people that have in need of legal help and to give them some pointers. But if they do want to get in touch with you guys, what's the best way that they can do that?
Telephone, email. You can look on our website. There's all the information, contact information there, or our telephone number.
Yeah, 01327 301 771.
Excellent, just rolled off the tongue. Yeah. Thank you so much. So that's Gemma and Natalya from Rollasons Solicitors. Revolution.